مهمان امروز من در به عبارت دیگر اینجا در بیت المقدس رئیس جمهور 86 ساله اسرائیل، دولت مرد کهنه‌کاری که سالهاست خودش رو مدافع صلح با فلسطینی‌ها معرفی میکنه، اما عملا در دوره مسئولیتش مذاکرات صلح خاورمیانه به بن‌بست رسیده. اما این مقام سیاسی ایران رو بزرگترین تهدید امنیتی خاورمیانه میدونه. President Peres, welcome to Be Ebarat Digar.
Thank you.
I would like to start with the peace process. In 1994, you jointly won the Nobel Peace Prize for the work that you did in preparation and achieving the Oslo Peace Accord. 15 years on, you know better than I do that the West Bank is still occupied. Gaza Strip is under siege, and a number of Israeli settlers in the West Bank has multiplied. Do you think you have done enough as a Nobel Peace Laureate to basically meet the expectations from a Nobel Peace Laureate?
Enough is foreign to my philosophy. I never thought that anybody, including myself, does enough. We did our utmost. But the Oslo agreement brought to some results. First of all, we would never have peace withdrawn without the Oslo Accord. Secondly, the Palestinians will remain united as a terroristic group of people. Today you have a group of responsible Palestinians who are ready to negotiate for peace. This is a second very important achievement. You know, conflicts have their own nature. Some of them have a very long life expectancy. In Ireland, it took hundreds of years. So in the 15 or 16 years, I think we have achieved quite a great deal. And we continue. And I think that today we are near to peace like never before. We left Gaza completely. We dismantled our settlements. Gaza is not occupied. The siege is organized by the Hamas, because they shoot at us. Otherwise, there wouldn't be a siege either. The situation in the West Bank is improving economically. They are going to have this year a 7% growth. The mood is much better. And the differences were minimized to a reasonable gap that we can bridge over.
You've been an outspoken supporter of the Arab Peace Initiative.
Right.
Which was launched by King Abdullah back in 2002. The Arab Peace Initiative calls for complete peace between the Arabs and the State of Israel in return for the withdrawal of Israel to the 1967 borders. What has happened to that peace initiative?
It's alive, but it didn't become a reality. It's still a statement and not a proposal. You see, there must be an element of reciprocity in our negotiations with the Palestinians and the Arabs. The Palestinians, alas, have nothing to offer to Israel. The Arab world could have offered something which is not tangible, because Israel is giving back tangibilities. We are giving back land. And it could have been a little bit more generous. It would help the Arabs, the Palestinians. It would help the Americans, like, for example, a partial recognition. But they refused. You see, there was a saying, land for peace. Israel gave back 100% of the land, 100% of the water to Egypt and to Jordan. Did we get back 100% of the peace? I'm not sure. I know there is 100% stoppage of the bloodshed, which is important. So this time, what are they expected? To move a little bit in a more realistic expression of their policy. Because it's very difficult for the Palestinians, and they should also give a clear support to the elected president of the Palestinians, Abu Mazen. Instead, there are some of them that supports Hamas, who is a rebellion organization. They rebelled against the elected authority of the Palestinians. And Ahmadinejad is financing it. I think that's one of the reasons why the Palestinians don't have a state. He supports the split. And the split, which is both geographic and political, is postponing the finalization of peace between us and the Palestinians.
You speak about foreign influences on the split within the Palestinians. I have spoken to many members of the PA, who the Palestinian Authority, who accuse Israel of undermining their authority in their withdrawal from Gaza, in the release of prisoners, in even the recent scandal about the Goldstone report in the UN. The PA does have this feeling that Israel is undermining its authority.
You know, I can't go into polemics, but it started by the Palestinians calling to accuse Israel. You know, in the agreement, one country doesn't act against another one. It was an unfriendly act of the Palestinians at the beginning. That's how it started, don't forget it. It's not Israel who started. Then what's wrong with our withdrawal from Gaza? We told them, the territory is yours, we don't want to occupy. What's wrong? Now about the settlements. The issue, and let me explain, because I think many people don't understand what is the issue. The issue is East Jerusalem. Today, East Jerusalem is under the sovereignty of Israel. There is no way that Israel can give up part of the sovereignty or part of the land without going to the parliament. As long as we don't have an agreement, it won't happen. So first of all, we have to negotiate. Now, what are we suggesting to the Palestinians? We say, look, instead of having a negative equilibrium, let's make a positive equilibrium. We are building in East Jerusalem. We should permit you to build there too. Why do you have to go on the time, with issues which is very hard to solve? There are things that the Palestinians can claim. Maybe they will get it, maybe they won't get it, but only after the negotiations. You cannot have an agreement before negotiations, and you cannot put conditions before the negotiations. So I'm really referring to their reason.
What about incentives? There are many who suggest that the vast majority of the Israeli public doesn't have enough incentives to agree to a groundbreaking concession with the Palestinians, and that's why the status quo is in fact preferred by many Israelis.
That's not the case. Public polls shows clearly that most of the Israelis are ready to pay a very high price for it. Now, look at the record of the government. The previous government suggested practically to give back to the Palestinians most of the land, the difference maybe several percentage, that we also suggested a swap. And then we have withdrawal completely from Gaza, and we took back the settlers by force. Then before it, we gave back all the land, all the water, to Egypt, to Jordan. Would the Syrians participate? They could have too. But I'm telling you, Ahmadinejad is the man who kills the peace process and kills the chances for an early peace. In the north with Lebanon, who needs Hezbollah, tell me? They split the country. They're an army within an army. They're a state within a state. They're being financed by the present Iranian government. Now the Syrians want us to give them back the Golan Heights. If Hezbollah will go to the Golan Heights, we shall not give back the Golan Heights. We don't need an enemy nearby.
Mr. President, you refer to elements from outside the immediate surrounding of Israel who may be influencing...
Not influencing, financing.
Financing.
Training, providing arms. It's not just influence.
I would like to ask you, do you think there are things that Israel could do to support what are described as the moderates in the Palestinian Authority. For example, the issue of settlements, which the American administration has tried very hard to reach an agreement with the Israeli government. And we know that it's been stalled by the prime minister to a great extent. And ultimately, many say that Israel has scored a victory by forcing President Obama to back down on his demand to halt the settlements in the West Bank. Don't you think that contributes to the popularity of more radical elements like Hamas or Islamic Jihad?
You know, when it comes to radical enemies, radical groups armed, it's not a matter of majority and minority. Killers are stronger than the victims of them. Now, have a look from our standpoint. We left Gaza completely to the hands of the Arabs. Can anybody explain to us why did they take the land that we gave back to them and made it a basis to fire missiles against civilian life in Israel? Why? 12,000 missiles, what for? What was the reason? What are the purposes? That makes us careful. We cannot create again in the same situation in the West Bank. We have learned a bitter lesson. Now we dismantled the settlements. We chose that we were ready. And who did it? Again, a man who came from the right, Arik Sharon. So what is the complaint? We want to make sure that if it should leave territory, it won't become a basis for missiles again. And that is our basic right to defend our lives. But otherwise, look at, on the other hand, we support the attempt of the administration of Abu Mazen, of Abbas, to improve the economic situation in the West Bank. We have dismantled most of the checkpoints. We support their building of a new city. They are training a defensive force, which we support. We are ready to renew the negotiations tomorrow morning. So what is support? Now, we cannot intervene in their business, and we cannot claim publicly that we support them, because this will be counterproductive. But we support not the moderates and not the extremes. We support the process of peace, which is, I believe, a mutual interest.
Your prime minister has endorsed the concept of two-state solution after a long time, but with very, very harsh conditions. Recognition of Israel as a Jewish state, no army for the future Palestinian state, and no division of Jerusalem. I would like to ask you, if you were the president of the Palestinian Authority, would you have accepted such conditions?
Well, let me refer to each of those points. I should also refer to the settlements. The present prime minister agreed a freeze on the settlements. The only issue which is out of agreement is the natural growth, which is a small minority of the whole story. But otherwise, he agreed to freeze the settlements. He agreed not to build new settlements, not to confiscate land, not to invest money, to dismantle 20 odd settlements that were built without licenses. About the Union of Jerusalem, we are before negotiations. Everybody can take its own position, which is natural. There is always a difference between opening positions and fallback positions. But theoretically, there are two solutions for Jerusalem. One, to divide the city, and to other, keep it united and share it together. So there's nothing wrong with an opening position that says we want unity and we shall share with other religions rights and necessities and so on. So it's not such a bad condition. And then I would look at the Israeli prime minister in the eyes of them, the former one, the present one. They indicated they're ready to give back, as I said, 95% of the land. And now, you know, the settlements were put because they refused to make peace. Would the peace process go on, we wouldn't build settlements. But once you build settlements, the situation is changed. And I say half laughingly, you know, it is easier to make an omelet from eggs than to make eggs from an omelet. The situation was omeletted. It's not simple to separate the eggs today. In spite of it, we are trying to do it.
I would like to move on to the to what everybody is talking about these days, and it's the Goldstone report, of course. In an interview with Newsweek published this Saturday, you called the Goldstone report a great victory for terror.
Right.
Could you elaborate on that?
Sure. How did the whole story in Gaza start? Not by us. We left Gaza. You could have stopped the fire in Gaza on the next day we left. They initiated, and for 8 years, they fired over 12,000 missiles on the heads of innocent people in Israel. We restrained and restrained and restrained. And it's not only how many people were killed, but think about the sleepless nights of mothers and children in their hands, night in, night out. And the government has had to stop it. Without a strike, it wouldn't be stopped, as it wouldn't be stopped in the north. Everybody is criticizing us, but the ones who criticize us couldn't stop the firing. They were against it. They didn't say a word about it. They couldn't stop in the north, they couldn't stop in the south, so the army has had to intervene. And by the way, the ones who are claiming that there is misconduct, have a look at other places where you have terrorists. Look at the anti-terroristic measures taken by other countries. But they singled out Israel. Look at Afghanistan, look at Pakistan, look at Iraq, look at Chechnya, wherever you want. Why? You know, because Israel has one sin. We don't stand the chance of having a majority in the United Nations, even if we are right. There is built-in majority against Israel. The combination of the Arab League and the Muslim League and their followers creates a priority, a majority against us. We don't stand the chance. They have nominated a commission with an anti-Israeli majority. How can a anti-Israeli majority judge us objectively? Then in the recommendations, 26 of them, there is no single word about how to stop terror or accusing the terrorists. What sort of a judgment is that, my God?
Do you think in your attempt to stop the rocket fire, Israel should be permitted to breach the internationally accepted rules of war?
I don't think we did it. No, we shouldn't. Every operation is being checked carefully by judges and lawyers. We don't do it. But there is one problem which I have to admit. The existing laws of war refer to a war that doesn't exist anymore, to the classic war. There is no set of rules how to fight a lawless army, lawless terrorist. There is no code. And we are very much for it, we announced, to have a code referring to this sort of violence. Because it's one thing when an army fights an army and they have flags and they have uniforms and they have norms and they have flags. But when you take children or innocent people as human shield, or you commit even suicide, you know, according to our religion and I think also according to the Quran, you don't have the right to commit suicide. You don't have the right to kill yourself. You don't have the right to kill somebody else. And clearly you don't have the right to kill yourself in order to kill other people. So we would like to have a code, yes, and we shall respect it. Until then, we respect the existing references to a war adopted to the present situation.
I would like to move on to the Iranian nuclear issue. You say, and many Israeli statesmen say repeatedly, that the Iranian nuclear program is a threat to the world. Iran and many others in the region have the same sentiments about the Israeli nuclear capability. Would you be prepared to commit Israel to a nuclear-free Middle East?
It should be free from threat and free from war. Then it can be free from nuclear capacities too. But the problem with Iran is not just the nuclear capacity. It's the only member of the United Nations that threatened in full daylight to destroy another member of the United Nations, Israel. It's against the charter. It's against peace. And that is the worry, the combination of nuclear weapons, terroristic activities, support of terroristic activities elsewhere, supplying arms, and threatening to destroy another country. Do you know any country that Israel threatens to kill or to hurt? We don't consider anybody as our enemy. Iran is not our enemy. Islam is not our enemy. The enemies are only the violent, extremist, fanatic people like Ahmadinejad. What sort of a person is it? He denies the Shoah. He denies the Holocaust. He knows he has been there. You know, it's totally irresponsible, aggressive, light-minded. It's a shame. And I'm sure many Iranian people are ashamed of it, the combination of denial of the Shoah, the call to destroy a country, the supply of arms to Hamas, the supply of arms to Hezbollah. It's a combination. So it's not enriched uranium. It's enriched violence. And then also, I mean, one watches the situation in Iran itself, the discrimination of women, the unemployment. We know Iran as a culture. Persia is a story in history. Look what he did to it. He made out of a great culture, a great shame. He converted Iran into a worry instead of a model. And I can see that even the government admitted that there were 15 million people in Iran that voted against this terrible system. So the problem is not Iran, even not just the nuclear attempt, but the overall picture of violence, of wilderness, of extremism, of hatred, of threats. You cannot separate them.
Mr. President, many of the issues that you touched on about Iran are, of course, domestic issues of Iran.
Sure.
But in terms of regional issues, if we look at Iran's record, Iran has not invaded or attacked any of its neighbors in the past 200 years. Now, taking out the rhetoric, which would be, I'm not trying to defend the rhetoric at all, taking out the rhetoric, do you still think that Iran should be a priority as a security concern for the world?
Not Iran, Ahmadinejad. In the 200 years, there were different governments. We are not fighting the Iranian people. We are fighting a most unusual phenomenon you won't find in the world, any other system, and a leader who is so outspokenly negative, insulting, inconsiderate. And it's not only us. Most of the Arab world is worried about him. So don't make it 200 years. What is it, 10 years, 15 years, that's it. And I'm sure that the Iranian people will judge him. And I agree that this is a decision for the Iranian people to take. Why waste energy for hatred? Why waste resources in vain? Let's invest it in the future of our children, not in the future of your missiles or your uranium, enriched uranium. They don't have a future. The world will not have a single solution that results from a nuclear option. Why should they threat others? And even today, we show that the historic collective judgment will be the future of our relations, of friendship, of understanding, each of us speaking his language, each of us maintaining its civilization, each of us praying to the Lord in its own language, and work for a world which is peaceful, flourishing, harmonized in spite of the differences, and offer the children happiness and understanding. So my message is a message of friendship.
Thank you very much, Mr. President, for being on Be Ibarat Digar.
Thank you very much.